साथी है। तेरा
गुड आफ्टरनून ऑल। सो टुडे इज द सेकंड लेक्चर ऑफ द वेबिनार सीरीज ऑन एडवांस्ड टेक्निक्स इन बायोटेक्नोलॉजी। सो गुड आफ्टरनून डॉक्टर स्टालिन राज। And so I'm introducing, this is third lecture in the series, and today's speaker is Dr. V. Stalin Raj, and he's associate professor from School of Biology, ICER, Trivandrum. So I request Dr. Gibbons, assistant professor from the Department of Plant Biotechnology, to introduce the speaker.
Thank you, ma'am. Good afternoon to all. As we all know that today the world is fighting with COVID, and we are witnessing an unprecedented form of physical, social, and financial ill health, or we are being affected physically, socially, and financially. So there are labs around the world which are all doing research on war foot to develop vaccines. And here we have today with us Dr. Stalin Daj, who is also working on development of corona vaccines. He is the associate professor in the School of Biology, who is an eminent virologist in India. And he has started his career as a microbiologist in University of Madras. And he did his master's in biotechnology from Madurai Kamaraj University. And he was awarded a doctorate for his thesis on studies on viruses which affects the tiger prawns. And later he moved to Europe, to specifically to University of Liège in Belgium, to do his postdoctoral research. And after 3 years of postdoctoral research, he joined Erasmus Medical Center, which is one of the prestigious medical research facility in Europe and a world-renowned one. And after working as scientist there for 7 years, he came back and to India and joined our neighboring institute, which is ICER, which is another prestigious institute in India. So to his credit, he has more than 120 publications, ranging from journals like New England Journal of Medicine, Nature, Science, The Lancet, PNAS, etc. And he also holds a patent on human beta coronavirus, its lineage C, and also for invention of various diagnostic and prophylactic measures to defend against the beta coronavirus. And his lab is focusing on emerging and re-emerging viral diseases in human, livestock, and also in wildlife. So he is the best person to teach us about or tell us about the development of vaccines on corona. And he has been instrumental in developing various vaccines, and also he has worked a lot his whole career on the coronavirus, which causes diseases like SARS, MERS, and COVID. So these are the three different diseases which he has put his prime focus on. And he has also instrumental in discovering a large number of other viruses like ferret hepatitis E virus, ferret and bat coronavirus, snake arena virus, etc. So he is also serving as a nodal officer in the state's defense against the COVID disease. So I welcome you, sir, to deliver your talk. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. So thank you for the so nice introduction about me. Thank you, madam, for inviting me and give a talk on coronaviruses. So can you see my slides? I'm audible?
Yeah. Yes, it's visible, okay. And you're audible.
Yeah. Okay. So actually, you know, I'm working on coronaviruses for the past 10 years. So I worked on different viruses, as he mentioned. Today, I'm going to explain about the success story of mine only. I'm not going to talk much about other stuff. Mainly, I'm going to discuss about emerging viruses. I will give you a brief introduction about emerging viruses and re-emerging viruses, and other known coronaviruses, including SARS, MERS, and SARS-2, and the vaccines, how to develop your vaccines. So I will bring in a kind of story like that, so that you will get an idea what, you know, how can you make a vaccine, what are the things you necessary to generate a success vaccines. Okay, and at the end, I will also add some of the work that I'm currently working on coronavirus, COVID-19 also. Okay, so in start with, so you all aware of it, you know, emerging viruses. You might, if you Google it, You might have seen this picture, like this several different picture. I also took it from the internet, right? So you see, last 3 decades, so more than 35 new viruses have been discovered from, around the world. And that means new viruses mean that is only human viruses. Okay, it's not any human. There are many multiple viruses. Only you're talking about the virus that can cause disease to humans. So we often term called, emerging or re-emerging viral diseases. I think this is a general term. Emerging viruses is meaning that it's a suddenly, without any notice, suddenly it's appear in a human populations and causing disease to people. This is the term called emerging viruses. Sometimes, some of the viruses, they appear, they cause disease, then they disappear for some time, then come back in the next episode and cause disease. That's called re-emerging viral pathogens, if you have asked me a simple term. So the questions, always we ask the why. Until yesterday, there is an old virus. Actually, until December 2019, there was no coronavirus, actually no COVID or anything, but suddenly you're coming from somewhere else. Like that, we often see dengue, chikungunya, and so on. Many new viruses suddenly appear in the human populations and causing serious disease to humans. The question is where these viruses are coming from. Because it's still yesterday, it's not there, but where is it? Actually, these are not human viruses, okay? These are animal viruses. Animal viruses means they are happily living in the animal population without showing any clinical symptoms or disease to this species. So, okay, one second. I will point here. Okay, so actually they doesn't show any clinical symptoms or any disease as ever. For example, if somebody has a disease, if you have a symptoms, then you only say disease. Otherwise, you never say disease. You also often get some sneezing, maybe some influenza viral infection. You sneeze one time, so you go away. So you never called as a disease, no? Like that, this is, animal viruses also, they circulate in this animal. They replicate very well. They maintain this species without showing any clinical. Therefore, you may not notice in this species whether they virus circulating this animal or not. That's a big problem. So whenever you have a close contact, then you have a chance of cross the species barrier. The animal viruses can cross the species from animal to human, or they can also transmit between the animal as well. Okay, this is even called zoonotic transmission because the animal virus coming from animal to human. So this is the ones that they jump across the species to one to species to another, they will adapt it to the new species. They replicate very well. Then also they transmit between human very efficiently. Like as you see in COVID-19, COVID actually is happened in Wuhan, slowly jumped one from to animal, humans. Then they, we don't know where it is coming from, but it is appeared in a human population. Then it's spread across the globe. Okay, like that. So this is actually, is called a zoonotic virus. If you want to ask, around 60-70% of the emerging viral pathogens are zoonotic viruses. So if you want to know notable examples, West Nile virus, one of the best example, if you think of it, HIV infection, cowpox, monkeypox, SARS, or Nipah virus, avian Spanish flu, or avian influenza or other influenza, swine flu, so on. Okay, there are many examples. So coronavirus is also, similar to the is a similar type of zoonotic virus, essentially. It's the only thing is the name is something different. This is a structure wise the virus is crown like morphology. It look like exactly like a crown, and they called as a coronavirus. But if you look at the structure of the virus, is viruses, viruses have a very simple architecture. They have only one type of genetic material, either RNA or DNA. Okay, that is one. The second part is they covered the genetic materials covered with the type of protein. So actually few proteins only. So actually if the composition is proteins and also layer of a genetic material, that is the only thing you can find in the viruses actually. If you think about the coronaviruses, it is quite large genome size compared to other viruses. For example, dengue, chikungunya, and all other Nipah virus, they all RNA viruses, but they have a smaller genome. Around maximum is you can 12 kb, you can see it. But this coronavirus genome is quite larger in size, around to 26 to 32 kilobase in size. It's a quite large genome. And it's surrounded by a protein called membrane nucleocapsid on the in the genetic material. On top of this nucleocapsid, there's a protein called membrane proteins. On the top, you know, a kind of shell actually. You can imagine, recall it egg, you know, egg you have a yellow, then under within covered by a small membrane, and inside there is a egg white. On the top, you have a membrane, and around surrounded by a shell, am I right? So similar type of architecture only. The top you see a protein called envelope protein. So actually this is most of the viruses have a envelope protein is the same, but architecture. But only thing is the name we use is different. It depends on the viruses. For example, HIV you say glycoprotein 120 or glycoprotein 40. If you think about the dengue viruses, you say envelope protein. So when the coronaviruses, what we say is it's a spike glycoprotein. Okay, this is a spike glycoprotein. Okay, but if you think about genome is, as I mentioned, it's quite a larger genome. That makes the complexity in this virus. If compared to other viruses, genome is smaller size, their replication very far. But in this case, there is a one larger genome. It's called around one third of the genome is covered. One of the two larger polyprotein called ORF1A and 1B, and one third of the part is around 10 kb is non-structural protein, spike protein, and other accessory proteins. So the larger polyprotein is cleaved into into structural and cleaved into non-structural protein later on. So we look at the viral life cycle. Actually, the coronaviruses always bind to the cell surface receptor. They do the receptor mediated endocytosis. They bind on the cell surface receptor. See here, spike protein is bind on the receptor, then go through the endocytosis by a clathrin mediated endocytosis. Once it goes in, the virus is after late endosomes, the protein is cleaved, fused, and the genetic material is actually cleaved. So one of the important point in coronavirus is, so I said it's a large genome. So it's also positive sense RNA genome. Positive sense means it's similar to messenger RNA. It's a messenger RNA. What they do, they code for a protein. The messenger RNA binds the ribosomes, then they start synthesis the protein. Actually, similar format is a kind of a positive sense RNA means is actually exactly the kind of mRNA. They can positive sense, once they release the genetic material, they can bind it on the ribosome, they can start protein synthesis. So other hand, they also make their own copy, they make the positive sense RNA. On the other side, they generate a protein. Finally, the protein, the nucleocapsid bind to the RNA copy and pack them. The virus will be released in the circulation outside the cells. Then the virus infected the neighboring cells. So on the cycle, the virus life cycle goes on. For example, one of the important points in coronaviruses, I told you, is when you compare to other viruses. For example, dengue viruses. Dengue virus infect human, right? Dengue or chikungunya. But in this case of coronaviruses, it's a unique characteristic. The viruses, infect all type of animals. They can find coronaviruses found in all kind of domestic animals, wild animals also, including humans or bats, birds, and very different, you know, they have a different wide range of host tropisms. That's a, is a different characteristics in terms of coronaviruses. What they do is, why I'm saying this, you know, so why if it is, this is very essential to know this is because, you know, if you are a single cells, if you are in a single cell, there is a two closely related viruses infected on a single cells. What they can do, they can also recombine with the they exchange genetic material between two viruses and they form another type of virus. So that's a recombinant virus they can, there are possibilities to have that. So there's another issues in this, the coronavirus as well. So actually, you know, coronavirus, I said, it is a wide tropism, but also there are different types of viruses. But the first coronaviruses was discovered in 1930. You know, one of the virus, I think, nobody knows until 2019, nobody, I think India, nobody knows, because I gave several talks around the country here on coronaviruses. Nobody, you know, listen on coronavirus because nobody interested. If somebody's giving a dengue, if you talk about, many people interested on it. We want to talk on coronavirus, nobody. After 2020 only, the entire things changed now. So actually, for us, it took around, you know, it's 90 years to know about coronavirus. Actually, coronavirus was first discovered in 1930. The virus was, the name called this, you know, IBV, infectious bronchitis virus. It's a chicken virus. I think you might have seen, you know, if you have a backyard, if you have a chicken, they have like kind of, you know, like kind of, you know, breathing problem sometimes, you know, people give some onion and some kind of treatment they will give. Actually, this is one of the causative agent for infectious bronchitis virus, you know, caused by IBV. So actually, the second virus, the first human virus was discovered in 1967, was the human coronavirus 229E. Actually, later on, there are several viruses have been identified. So one of the things is, in this virus, you know, coronaviruses usually doesn't cause any disease. It's not easy, you know, maybe you may get infection, you will get a, you know, you, in 1 day or 2 days, you will get a, you know, 1 day you will get a sneezing, then you disappear. I think, for example, if you take a OC43 is one of the human coronaviruses. It's coming from bovine, it's a cows, okay. So I think if you look at the antibody from you, many of you, I think if you 100 people sitting here, I think more than 50% have this antibody against this particular virus. So actually, there are, that means you also might have infected with the virus. We never notice it, actually. Does that mean this coronavirus? There's a reason nobody interested in coronavirus, because coronavirus doesn't cause any serious disease until 2003. Okay, 2003. That things have changed because, you know, there was in March 12, 2003, there is a WHO, a World Health Organization, giving a notice and to give a circular saying that there is an outbreak, you know, disease outbreak ongoing in China, it's in Hong Kong actually. So there is, this is a disease, when you treat this, you know, the people have a severe fever, and also some of them have a diarrhea and also breathing problem. If we give you a treatment with the antibiotic, it doesn't help. So basically, antibiotics is well for the bacterial infection, but in this case, doesn't happen. So they said something like a contagious virus, and also they spread and within the community, and also they spread around the world also. So then the people try to, and because of course any scientist, you know, always think about it, you know, something outbreak happen immediately, they will try to understand what is happening there. So actually, you know, it was a surprising that times, you know, it is first time in March 23, CDC, actually Center for Disease Control, is announces this is the causative agent for this disease was coronavirus. It was a surprising, because until that moment, nobody knows coronaviruses that can cause a disease to human or not. So because nobody bother about it. So there are two papers in one of the prestigious journal, New England Journal of Medicine, they published the papers, and they said it is a coronavirus actually. So what was interesting here, you know, this is a phylogenetic tree. I don't know if you know, when you identify the relationship between the two different viruses or group of viruses, we sequence the genome and make the phylogenetic analysis to calculate the distance, how far away, or we will find and identify who is belonging to whom. So we find out the relationship by making the phylogenetic analysis. If you look at this phylogeny, you see here, this is a group of viruses that is known viruses. Here is the green box here. This is the virus they identified from China. Actually, it is a highly divergent from all other known viruses. This is the first time they shown that this coronavirus is now found to human. It also is spread between human very efficiently. So one thing, you know, actually, this is, I said, no, this is a no relation here. This is highly divergent. The question immediately raised that, where is this virus coming from then? As I said, most of these emerging viruses are from zoonotic origin. One of the important clue for Chinese scientists, no, this is an example. I think I put this picture many of my talks, actually. Many of you might have seen it, actually. So this is, you know, this is a Chinese animal market, actually. So the animal market means in China, you know, if you go to the market, you can see everything you can see on live, actually. It's not like here. I think we in India, we see only live things, just only in chicken, I think you will see in live. And other than that, you cannot see it. But there, everything on live, everything, you know, these are not, is not for, you know, pet animal anymore. So it's for slaughtering. Okay, they have all the reptiles and insects. And so if you don't believe, this is also, I often put this as this is one of the menu card from, I took it from the internet only, but I have seen myself in Hong Kong. So this is a menu card. You see, this is a food. It's available in this particular restaurant. This is a soup, you know, this is a soup. They put them on the belly of the bats, you see. So the culture is something different. But the scientists thought, could be, you know, the virus might have coming from the Chinese live market. Then they try to collect samples from these animals and tested them for coronaviruses. What they found it very interesting was they found out similar type of virus. Actually, this is a human virus if you look at this phylogeny. But these are the virus they identified from civet cat. The civet cat is a cat, is the one they used to eat as a meat, you know, it is a civet cat. So it was very surprising at the time. Later they did several research. Actually, if you think of, make it short, I will explain what actually happened. The virus was originally from bat, actually. They uses ACE2 angiotensin converting enzyme 2 as an end receptor for this virus, actually. What happened, this virus, they jumped from bat to civet cat by adopting their genetic material, by basically in the spike protein. So to this civet cat ACE2, then they jump from civet cat to the humans. So what actually happened, this civet adopted strain doesn't grow anymore, actually, in bat. Actually, that was but that means the virus jumped long back ago from bat to the civet cat. Then they were maintaining this particular course, then jumped to the civet cat to humans. This was an actual story. So in that time, you know, because suddenly jumped and they tried to control the outbreak. But that time they could to control the outbreak very quickly. What they do, they did the 145. What happened in India recently, they closed entire street, actually, like a 144. They cleaned all the entire street and markets, and also killed all these civet cats and also live animals in the live market. And the live market also shut down. And finally, they could able to control the outbreak, actually, within 6 months, actually. So initial case was November 22, then March 12th only, actually the WHO, World Health Organization, give you alert to the public. Then they identified within a short time the host, and they developed a series of diagnostics and identify the pathogens, and they could able to control the outbreak. Okay, so during that time, because now actually this is 2003, and during that time I was also trying, I was at the Erasmus Medical Center, I'm trying to trace back, you know, viral pathogens in different animals, actually bats, squirrel, you know, reindeer or reptiles, what are the different types of viruses present in this animal, whether if you identify one, whether they can be able to cross the species barrier or not. So on, I was working on that time. That during that time, it's actually exactly 10 years later of the SARS outbreak. There is a man, actually, he's around a 60 years old man, was admitted in hospital, actually in Saudi Arabia. He had actually a heavy fever and also pneumonia, breathing problem. But he also have some kind of, you know, kidney failure and all. So what happened during that time, doctors, you know, tried to give a lot of, because if you look at his x-ray or chest x-ray, see, he has a pneumonia, actually. Pneumonia, you can see like a foggy, this actually is a mucus, actually is a kind of, so it's a pneumonia. Doctors gave him a lot of antibiotic to treat him. Unfortunately, he died because of the you know, treatment failure or so, or other disease. But what happened, one of the scientists, he took the samples and tested for all known viruses, is negative for all known viruses actually. Then he sent the sample to, he also cultured them in the lab, and he also took a supernatant and then he tested them, and he could not find any viruses. And so his name was Dr. Professor Sagi. He is an Egyptian scientist. And then he sent it to our lab at Erasmus Medical Center. We test them actually. We have a very good, well-established diagnostic setup in our institute. Erasmus Medical Center is a medical center, actually. It's one of the largest medical center. So we have a big virology lab also. So we tested that. What we found it, you know, around, we did a small PCR only, around 400 base pair product we amplified from the sample. When you sequence them, they found it's a coronavirus, actually. It was quite surprising again. So this the sequence, the virus is highly divergent than the SARS coronavirus, which is more closely related to bat coronavirus. At the time we named that, it's actually human coronavirus, EMC. Now the ICT, we renamed them Middle East Respiratory Syndrome coronavirus. So what is interesting in this one? No? So we know that the small piece itself, we could see that the difference actually is a huge, you know, is a highly divergent from the other known virus. So then what we thought immediately, we collected, you know, the you know, a lot of bats, different bat species, and we bat kidney cells, actually we grown them, and for example, then we tried to culture this virus on the in the bat cell lines, so different cell lines. For example, we know that already SARS coronavirus doesn't grow in bat cells. If you look at this, this is different cell types here. This is SARS grow, doesn't grow actually, and so like a background. So it doesn't grow. When you take bat cells, if you put them human ACU2 receptor, then this virus, the SARS-CoV, become susceptible for the virus infection. In contrast, if you put the immersed coronavirus in these cells, what happens is these cells is growing very, very efficiently. You know, they replicate very well. They produce high titer as well. This gives us a hint that this virus is an entirely different virus compared to other viruses, a new virus that is maybe a different phenotype than other virus. So, of course, you know that when you have a new virus, it's a lot of new things to study. You need to develop diagnostics. You need to understand the basic biology of the virus. It's quite a lot. So, actually, one of the main thing is, you know, the receptor. So actually, viruses, you know, I told you, the first, you know, bind the cell surface receptor to initiate the virus infection. If you interrupt this interaction between receptor and spike, you can already intervene the interactions, and ultimately you can develop your therapeutics, actually. Either you can make antibodies, or you can add, not antibiotics, sorry, antibodies, or you can use drugs that target here in the receptor binding domain of the spike. So one of the thing is, you know, the first thing is, you know, we asked the questions. whether this virus is originally coming from the bat or not. It's because we have a long history of, you know, so bat is a reservoir for many viruses. That is the reason we always ask this question. So originally is from bat or not, or they're using the same receptor like a SARS, then whether the virus by bat to jump to another intermediate host, from there then jump to human, or what are the receptor, what is the genetic variation, so on. We ask several different questions. So but of course, if you know, have any new viruses, if you answer any biological question, one of the major thing is you need a diagnostics. Okay, proper diagnostics is very, very essential to answer many of the questions. First thing is we do, you know, so spike protein, you know, spike is actually a coronavirus have a trimeric form of the protein. There is a two domains. One is called S1, another two is S2 domains. The S1 domain is here. You see, this is the domain is initially binded to the cell surface receptor. What we did, we clone the spike protein and produce them in a recombinant protein, and we inject them in animals and produce a polyclonal antibody. We developed various diagnostics to make it short. We made the ELISA or microarrays, virus neutralization assays. We validate epitope mapping by neutralization assay, sandwich assay, ELISA, so on. We developed, first thing is, this is the one we created in our lab. Very quickly, within few weeks time, we produced many of the new assays in DIETWA. So then using this tools will help us to develop various, you know, to do various basic research. First question again we asked, what is the receptor? Are these viruses using the same receptor as SARS, like SARS or not? So as I mentioned in previous slides, first thing is I told you the S1 diamond as the spike protein is binding, you know, the binding to the cell surface receptor. So what we did, we cloned this spike protein and fused with the human immunoglobulin FC domain and make them as a dimeric protein. Actually, it's 120 kilodalton protein. Then we did them co-immunoprecipitation with the susceptible cells. For example, HUH7 cells, Vero cells. These cells are susceptible for MERS coronavirus. So we lyse those cells, then we did a co-immunoprecipitation. So interestingly, we found, you know, when you do a co-IP on HUH7 cells, we found 110 kilodalton protein was co-purified along with the spike protein. When you do when you cut out that particular band and you do mass spec, we found dipeptidyl peptidase 4. Actually, this was we did a several follow-up studies to prove that DPP4 is a dipeptidyl peptidase 4 as a end receptor for this virus. If you want, you can read my article. So we have led a lot of experiment to prove that actually. So in this study, first we actually, this is the first time somebody is showing that the DPP4 as a protein act as a receptor for any of the known viruses. The first report is for as a DPP4 as a receptor. So in this case, what we do, what we did, you may ask, what is the importance of receptor? One thing I told you, identification of receptor, we have a lot of function. I will show you follow-up slides what will be the advantage for identifying the receptor. One of the thing I will tell you here in this paper, what we did, one of the thing is, you know, we shown the bat DPP4 also enabled the virus infection in a MERS-CoV infection in non-susceptible cells. That means bat could be the possible reservoir for the virus. In addition to this, we could able to prove this, the theory, actually the transmission of the virus between human to human transmission, this virus was less, very limited compared to SARS coronavirus. The reason is very simple, I will tell you. I don't know, you know, if you look at the respiratory tract system, you have a two part. One is upper respiratory tract, another one is lower respiratory tract. The lower respiratory tract, you know, upper respiratory tract, you have one type of cells, is a more abundant in ciliated cells, you know, ciliated cells. But in the lower respiratory tract, you have a lot of non-ciliated cells. What we took, we took a lung tissue, or we also lung cells also we grown, we did to do them too. Then we did the DPP4 staining on this lung tissue samples. So what we found very interesting is, here you see red, these are non-ciliated cells expressing the DPP4, whereas ciliated cell doesn't express the DPP4, which is, this is a contrast to the SARS-CoV receptor, SU2 express, or SARS-CoV-2 or COVID-19, the receptor is ACE2 is present upper respiratory tract. This virus receptor is present in the lower respiratory tract. Imagine it. If there is a virus, you need a low amount of virus to touch the nose. It's a virus that easily enter the cells. They can replicate. They can also transmit because immediately you're breathing, you can very quickly can go out. Also, they can go inside the lungs. You can have a disease. Whereas this virus in the upper respiratory tract, no infection, when go inside your lungs, the virus replicate very fast. And also, you need a lot of virus to know. You need to, you know, you need a strong cough to spread the virus. What we proved here, this virus is a less transmissible than the compared to the SARS coronavirus at that time. So later, we know we tried because to make it short. So we also identify the receptor binding domain because DPP4 is a large protein, around 760 amino acid. So we identify the exact locations where this particular protein is binding it. Actually, by for example, I will tell you, make it short. Maybe you don't look at us. This is so complicated, right? This animal is a ferret. Okay, the human DPP4 is this one. We know that if you transfect the cells on non-susceptible cells, this virus can permeable in the cells. But if you ferret DPP4, is a non-permeable. This is non-susceptible for the virus. That means if you are ferret DPP4 or non-susceptible for virus infection, you can see here. If you DPP ferret cells, DPP4 will be expressed, but the spike protein of the MERS coronavirus doesn't bind it. That's the reason virus cannot go inside. Okay, so what we did is a chimeric DPP4. This is a human DPP4. The red one is ferret DPP4. We made a chimera between ferret and human. For example, the middle fragment of ferret DPP4, we put them in the human backbone. Similarly, we put the ferret backbone, we put the human DPP4 to the around 200 amino acid. When you do so, what happened? This fragment, the 244, we exchanged it in ferret. This ferret DPP4 becomes susceptible for the virus infection. So then finally, we are able to confirm this by a lot of mutational site-directed mutational analysis, so on. We could do the pinpoint, the location where this virus is binding it. Okay, so we identify here the receptor binding domain. So then we ask, what is the purpose of, you know, identifying? Yes, actually, what we did, it was a very interesting finding for us on our side. You know, we know that, you know, the receptor binding domain is a 240 amino acid. What we did, we took this 240 amino acid and made a file of different animal species. For example, human to even hamster, different animal DPP4. We made a phylogenetic tree. What we found very interesting is, you know, human here, no? We know human DPP4 are susceptible. That DPP4 here, we are susceptible. So we assume that time itself, this species might be susceptible for the virus infection. This is may not be not susceptible for the virus infection. Is indeed that true? We tested all these animals in vitro and also in vivo, except horse. All these animals are susceptible for the virus infection. These all, we never tested dogs, but all other species already we tested in vitro and all. So none of them are susceptible for the virus infection. So indeed that this is to help us to develop an animal model for virus, because animal model is very essential if you develop a drug, if you develop a vaccine. You need a model that mimics as a human, you know, symptoms that can you test. Unfortunately, none of the animal models, you know, mimic like a human diseases. So therefore, still the rabbit is model, rabbit and marmosets are okay, but still it is not as like a human symptoms or diseases. So still people are trying to develop, and now people are developing transgenic mice and all developed. So what we did, I'm talking about mainly on what we did. And it's so in addition to this, you know, as I told you, this kind of, you know, a new idea and hypothesis help us to trace back the animal which might be the possible, you know, intermediate host for this virus. As I mentioned to you here, no, we know that these are all possibly they are susceptible for the host species. So what we did, we try to trace back this animal, actually, you know, this is this entire study we finished actually later on, but I put it in another in early slide, so don't make it confused. Actually, this is initially we didn't test all this, but it took 6-7 years to complete all of this. Initially, we tested a few. Later, we completed all of this with this theory. So initially, in the early stage itself, based on this phylogenetic tree, we could able to trace back the animal which one could carry the virus. Actually, we found out, you know, we were tracing back the animal. We found out the virus that is circulating in camel. Very interesting, actually. We found, you know, we identified antibody against this virus in camels. Later, we identified we isolated the live virus from camels, actually. So now what we know now is currently we almost tested camels around the world, except actually India. My project proposal is under government desk somewhere else. So, but we tested all of them, but except America and Australia, all others are animal camels are positive for this virus. So that means now we conclude that the camel is an intermediate host for this virus. So one of the additional finding what we found it very interesting was the camel, young camel is shedding high level of infectious virus. That means, you know, if you do a nose swab of young camels, you're around 1 year or 6 months, they have a high level of infectious virus. That means there's a reason the virus, one animal to another, they're spreading very, very rapidly. When you have a human have a close contact with this species, they will easily get the virus infection, So one of the thing is, how to control this outbreak is a vaccines, because therapeutics very difficult, because as I mentioned it earlier, this is SARS outbreak, they kill, shut down everything and they kill the all the animals, the civet cat and all, but in the case of camel, if you tell them the camel owner, they will kill you. So because the cost of each camel is $1 million worth, because they use for the racing, camel racing, okay, in the Middle East region. I think you might have heard about it. So one of the best option is developing vaccines, or there are other therapeutics would be the best option to control this outbreak. So we were interested into develop vaccines. So the vaccines is a possible option. There are, the vaccine is a very large field, and in it, a lot of studies, basic research, and other stuff needed to develop a proper vaccines. Coronavirus, I told you, the spike protein is essential for the virus attachment and entry. So the spike protein is, the S1 domain of the spike protein is the one, could be the binding to the cell surface receptor and initiate the virus infection. If you can, this domain can be used as a vaccine candidate for making it. So to first we did what we did them in one of the assay, we took this S1 spike protein, we chop up into different domains, small pieces, and we produce as a recombinant protein. Those protein we immunize and inject them in mice. And after boost immunization, we collect sera and test them, which domain, we tested for the neutralizing activities. So then we wanted to know which domain have a high immunogenicity. Okay. So what we found very interesting was this 358 to 588 region was highly immunogenic when you compare to others. Even if you do whole, the domain, if you hold spike, if you immunize them, then by the virus neutralization titer is around 1,000. But if you do them, they are the 358 and the 358 to 588 is the domain is more than 4,000 virus neutralization titer. So moreover, what we found, the first fragment 1,2,3,5,7 also capable of induce immunogenicity as well. So in this experiment, what we found very interesting was, we know at that time, because this is as soon as we identify the virus, this experiment being done, and we found out this could be this region is a receptor binding domain. So that's why then, because this is a spike domain, and then we decided maybe S1 domain, not a complete S1 domain, one domain is is enough to make a vaccine. So not due to vaccine, as I told, is a vast subject. How are you going to make a vaccine? Vaccine can be, you can make in a different forms. Okay, there are different levels. So one of the thing is you can make a, you can produce a protein and you can have a subunit vaccine, or you can make a, you can put them in a nanoparticles, you can make a nanoparticle based vaccines, or you can make a, you know, self-assembled nanoparticles, you can make a nanoparticle based vaccine, or you can clone them in a vector. I will show you, explain detail in next few slides, in vector based vaccines, or you can make the RNA of this, you know, the transcript of this, the spike protein, you can put them in a, in a lipid membrane. Then you vesicles, you can make a lipid base, actually mRNA based vaccine. So there are several platforms is available. You can make it whatever. The people are still trying to develop, you know, better vaccines for. What is the main condition for vaccines? One of the part is. So, you know, antibody mediated immunity. So the second point is your immune antigen. Antigen should be immunogenicity, that has to be neutralized your virus. That means antibody mediated immunity. The second point is the cell mediated immunity. That means if there's a cells infected by the virus, the T cells identify particular infected cells, they kill the infected cells. So that's a two way, you know, your immune system will work in that case. So that means your immunogen should be induced T cell, you know, cell mediated immunity and also humoral immunity. Okay, so here we have one of the few example I put. One is via viral like particles or liposomes or self-assembled protein. Actually, there are self-assembling protein is very simple, because I think because this is what I put, it's a lot of you are plant biotechnologists, that is very interesting for you. People can, you know, think of some of the protein or some of the particle you can develop and produced in plant system. Okay, because producing recombinant spike protein or the viral-like particles is quite challenging. Okay, because when you make a vaccine and large, so I think it will be interesting for plant biotechnologists that they think of the system that you can generate in plant. So if you have a recombinant protein, if you produce in plant, you can generate a lot of protein. Okay, so this protein is a self-assembled, it's a ferritin, it's a bacterial protein. So if we express the protein, then we'll be making in a 12-mer. It's a 24-mer actually, you know, like a virus, like a particle. Later on, you can, you know, decorate your protein on the top, even your protein of your interest on the top here, like this. Then you can make a vector vaccines. Another one protein called lumasin synthase. This is also bacterial protein. If you look at our paper recently, we published in PNAS about this, the self-assembled nanoparticles.